Today's event here at the gallery is titled, Has Art Moved From a Personal Expression to a Cultural Expression? Okay, so that will be discussed. We'll see how it kind of goes. There's no really set format here. On the panel is Linda Siska. She's a pottery teacher. George Ramirez, design teacher, animation teacher, works in the marketing department, all around. Keith Hollingworth. Come on, guys, come on. We have a room right up front for you guys. Come on, Eve, yeah, Jake, Anthony, right here. In the sculpture department, and then Maggie Nowinski, who's also a member of the art department. To my left here is Angela Zammarelli. She's going to be the moderator of the afternoon program here. I met Angela 10 years ago, I think. We did a program called Massachusetts Art All-State. Any of you guys participate in that? When did you participate? 2 years ago?
Yeah.
Right. So it was at Worcester Art Museum.
I went to Mass Dartmouth. Yeah.
So I was there.
Yeah.
Yes. It's a program for where high school juniors can apply for a weekend art making project. So that's where we met. And then one time we were actual studio mentors together. And then in 2008 I moved here and Angela was here. And then we lived in the same town.
Yeah.
And kids the same age and all that stuff there. Angela received her BFA from UMass Dartmouth in UMass Amherst in 2003.
Hi, Valley.
Her MFA from Minneapolis College of Art and Design in 2007. She's also the 2011 Massachusetts Cultural Council Fellow in Sculpture and Installation. Big deal. Among other things, she's recently shown at STIC last year, is that right? Springfield Community College?
Yeah.
Recently at Holyoke Community College and kind of throughout the valley there. So I'm going to welcome Angela. I don't know what she has prepared here for a direction, if she would have to discuss and then have interaction with you guys. We'll kind of see what happens here. So please welcome Angela.
It's a little different than the other question, and I'm hoping our conversation moves to the big question of the is this panel discussion. So, excuse me. I find this a curious question. Has art moved from a personal expression to a cultural expression? Because to be honest, in my own practice, I've not thought about it so directly. My definition of art currently is messy and a bit all over the place, much like I perceive our culture to be at this moment. So while I surely do think art is moving, I am not at liberty to say from what to where. How wonderful we can meet here today with Professors Keith Hollingworth, Maggie Nowinski, George Ramirez, Linda Siska, and David Chapley to explore their practices as artists, educators, and appreciators of art. So, under Professor Hollingsworth's piece, Blue Moon, over here, he states, art should be subjective, introspective, and meditative. To open up our discussion, I would first like to ask each of the artists to talk about what they hope to experience when witnessing another artist's work. And see, sort of posit you within a cultural conversation of what you build around yourself, and then maybe that'll help us move into this bigger question. So, anybody
want
to
go first?
I'll start.
Now you go ahead.
I'm a graphic designer, so I think when I look at other people's work, I look for visual communication, because that's what I strive to bring forth in my own work. So each artist has a statement, each artist has a focus, and when I look at a piece, I want to see if it's communicating properly to me, flat out. It's just that simple. I also look at technique, but I do look at the underlying, what are they saying to me?
I once had a mentor who said, we talked about what the definition of a good pot is, and there really is no one conclusive definition, but he always said a good pot would be one that when you saw it, it would make you want to go home and make a pot. And I think that goes kind of along with what George is saying, to be inspired or moved to the degree that it would move you forward in your own work. That's my response.
Yeah, I think that I can relate to that a lot. You know, I don't think there's any one thing that I look for when I first encounter artwork. I think that my approach is very open, and I look for something to participate with. And that might be something that involves, you know, the technique or the material or the medium, some kind of like formal application that makes me then want to make art, so inspiration on that kind of physical level. Or it might be some kind of narrative or something that maybe is more interactive. But what I look for is, I think, some kind of opening, like something to participate with. And I find it a lot.
I think the first thing that I would like to say is that I find very hard, in one sense, of being here tonight to talk about art because of the election last night. I personally am devastated by that, and the ramifications of that, I think, are far-reaching. So, having said that, to get back to the subject of art and my art, is that the things I'm interested in outside of so-called the art world are essentially things of a spiritual nature. I'm interested in Tibetan Buddhism. I'm interested in American Indian art and American Indians. I recently did a piece called 54 African Americans. Those are the kinds of things that engage me. In terms of artists that I look to, are those who, I guess you say, inspire me. They range from Georgia O'Keeffe to Agnes Martin to Carmen Herrera. I guess I'll leave it there.
If something visually engages me, how did they do that? Why did they do that? What kind of really draws me in? So maybe hiding material, why are they using that material? So that's what initially engages me. Narrative really does not usually engage me right away, but use of material, if it can make me stop and actually look at something for more than like 5 seconds, or I keep coming back to something, that's very, very relevant to me. So this kind of, there's more than one message, or there's something that kind of draws you into that there. And sometimes I'm trying to figure out what that is, or, you know, why they're doing that. It definitely draws me into looking at a particular piece or not looking at a particular piece.
Great. So sort of leads me in, you're all educators here, and I think in terms of speaking to, you're engaging with students and new minds and teaching them how to communicate visually, clearly, and you're engaging them in materials and sort of and aspects of looking and spirituality. So sort of I'd like you to talk about bringing your personal practices in with that, choosing to be educators, because there are a lot of artists who choose not to be educators, and sort of why that's important in your practice as artists, working with new minds, and sort of what that means for the future, even in what you hope to see within these people that you're sending forth as practicers of art, and I guess that's sort of what I'm saying. Sorry, I didn't think it clearly, but anyway. So does anybody have any thoughts on that to start?
Well, I think, you know, it's actually, it seems like, you know, I'd love to sort of say, like, this is why, you know, but it's something that I find continually changes, and I'm constantly sort of learning what it's about. That sort of relationship between being an educator and an artist, and that kind of experience of teaching and watching students kind of get familiar with materials. And I think that I'm constantly sort of questioning, to be honest, the practice of it. And what I find, you know, I find a lot of inspiration I don't know if inspiration is the word, but it's amazing to me how one can continually return to foundational practices in art and applications. And mostly, for the most part, that's what I'm teaching. I think the question, you know, for me, I also started working with a graduate student. And that's something that has a very different kind of conversation than working with mostly non-art majors in classes that are a little bit more about, very much about observation and very practical kinds of ideas. In terms of that, I think that what is exciting is visual thinking and sort of creative problem solving. And the surprise of how many different approaches to sort of the same kinds of problems, there are different solutions that come up. So, you know, even just sort of sharing that moment is very energizing, and I don't know that I can answer what I hope, what I hope or what I plan for students to take in the future, especially considering a lot of non-majors. And, you know, I sort of hope to engage that creative moment. Expand on that moment. So I think that was a little convoluted, but trying to sort of address that a little bit.
That's interesting, too, that you're working with a lot of non-art majors, mm-hmm. so that's great in terms of at least getting a little bit of that conversation to take into other areas. Like, I do
Absolutely.
Personally
yeah.
feel that art is as a opportunity to look at things very differently, and that it can bring you into other areas, and it can help you look at what you're looking at under a microscope differently, or like structures of things, and bringing
yes.
that to other places. So I think that's
Absolutely.
Wonderful that it comes from that
mm-hmm.
spot. So it's interesting in terms of reaching out culturally more than just in this this space, the cloistered spot.
And
of
a way
art.
Of kind of maybe questioning what observation is,
mm-hmm.
looking deeper, and maybe engaging a kind of empathy there too, for, you know, on a larger scale.
A lot of my work deals with basic shapes.
Mm.
And so teaching that, to me, makes total sense. If a work doesn't have that basic foundation or use of shape or non-use of shape or whatever, that's, I think, is a kind of what makes a work good, and it kind of keeps going from there. So I think teaching the basics is very, very, very important to kind of give them skills, you guys, to communicate what they want to communicate farther down the line through drawing, through use of color, through understanding value. So I really enjoy that basic level of reteaching and reteaching and reteaching that right there. And a lot of these guys know, a lot of them try to push them past what they think they can do or what art is. You know, a lot of people come in here with this is what I do, you know? And so I said to him, like, what do you know what you do? You're only 18 years old, you know, and kind of to be open to kind of push yourself beyond what you think you can do of what your art is.
You know, for me, as a designer, I was always hard on myself because I couldn't really create anything original. You know, I would create something, and then I'd see it in a magazine somewhere, and just like, well, this, I can't own it anymore. It's not mine. And through time and practice and education, I realized that graphic designers have something called a cycle of design or a cycle of style. It's a theory developed by Lorraine Wilde. So when I deal with younger people now, younger designers, I try to make sure that I instill that level of being okay with what you're creating, not to be hard on yourself, that everything is a cycle of style. Something gets born, it goes through its phase of being publicized, it burns out, it dies, but then it gets picked up again, and it goes through the cycle over and over and over again. I think what I enjoy is to paint someone's aesthetic, and then to make sure that it's not theirs to own. You know, it's the world will share it, and someone will take it, and someone will own it. And I enjoy that process. So that's kind of like my style of teaching.
So I feel I'm teaching clay, and I'm an adjunct. And so prior to teaching clay, I was surviving as a potter, barely. So if I were going to be totally honest, I would say why I began teaching was because there was a secure paycheck periodically through the year that I could count on. Then over time, the reality became that teaching became as meaningful or more meaningful to me than making my own pots. And it also informed my own pots. So I feel like they're... What I love the most about what I'm doing is the dialogue that continues in that pottery room between students with each other and between me and them. So I bring home with me as much as I'm bringing to the studio. And so I often say to my students, I'm not inclined to want everybody to become potters, but to know the techniques and appreciate clay and understand what you're saying when you see it. And also what I often say is so what I would love people to go away with is to take the creative energy that you apply to your art and transfer it into how you live your life. Because we're living at a time that isn't so secure for artists to survive, and it's going to be a struggle. So I think that, but everybody's creatively involved in their work. If you can redirect that and apply it to how you live your life, you will be doing a really good thing for yourself. And that's what I would love people to be here, thinking and knowing and doing.
So like on your webpage when you were talking about, I'm just gonna quote you so that I sort of get it right, but I taught a class this spring and became a student in it as well. So sort of that becoming part of it again, when you, one assignment, we asked us to research ancient symbols and stories as they were told on pots. So then you and your students created symbols, contemporary ones, sort of using this history. But I love that you talk about also being a student in that process too.
And I think that another thing really important to me is that we recognize that we are part of this continuum and that it isn't just us in this class on this day, on this semester. And that there's a whole tradition behind it of cultures and peoples for thousands of years in the world, and we are joining in on that train with all of those people, and we're adding our 2 cents to what they added. And that I love that concept, that it's not about us, the maker in this moment, it's more about who we are and what we represent over time. And who and what has influenced us over time, which leads right to your main question.
To be honest, I became a teacher because I realized I couldn't sell life insurance. I mean, I don't have those skills, you know, and I don't know how to sell real estate either. And, although I have spent many summers painting houses, I didn't get to sign them in the corner. I became a teacher because I wanted to teach, because I wanted to be continually involved in the process of art. And art is, in fact, a process. It's not a beginning, a middle, or an end. It's an ongoing situation. And I wanted to be involved in that. And, you know, when in a classroom situation, you know, you present a problem and students work on it, and they come up with solutions that I would not normally think of because they're not me, which is the way it should be. And I like to see students to, you know, from the beginning to the end of the semester, grow, change, alter, look, explore. And that keeps the quote-unquote art as such alive for me, okay? Because it's very easy as an artist to sort of slip away, okay? I mean, you know, there's some sort of statistics about, like, people who go on to get an MFA and graduate within about 3 years are no longer producing art, you know? Because the classroom situation is not a normal situation, you know? An artist is alone in his or her studio. Nobody's telling you, you know, nobody tells me to go there. Nobody tells me to do what I do and whatnot. And being involved with students and the classroom activity and all that is involved, that, you know, it's engaging. It's really engaging. And I just want to continue with that engagement, you know. The other thing that can happen is that I can steal ideas. You know, artists steal ideas from each other. They do it all the time. And, you know, one of the greatest ones was Picasso. You know, Diego Rivera used to say, like, when he was in Paris, he would not allow Picasso in his studio because he knew full well that if he saw some of Rivera's ideas, he'd probably take them and do them better than he could. And so, anyway, and that's another reason to be engaged in the classroom.
So I would like to move on. I feel like this question is a good segue into the big question. And then after that, I'd like to open up the floor for students to ask questions. So, please, Linda. I'll reiterate the question just one more time.
Okay.
Thank you. So has art moved from a personal expression to a cultural expression? Oh, and I would like to add one other thing. And personal expression actually isn't that old of a concept. It's actually from the turn of the last century. So is it sort of a fallacy that we've been building off of in the past 100 years? But that's just a little injection. But please start with your thought.
So,
thank you.
So I've thought about this a lot, and when the question was first raised, it seemed way too broad to me to really respond to intelligently. So what I did was move it into the area of play for me. So if I'm looking at whether or not the movement has been cultural or personal, I would say I'd be looking at like 14,000 years of play, and which has been very culturally integral in many cultures of the world over all that period of time. So you could name things like the tea ceremony in Japan, very much a part of the culture. You could name things like there are these life-size horses and soldiers that were created out of clay around 200 AD. And they were buried in a tomb with the emperor. And when they were, prior to their being made of clay, the tradition was that all the soldiers and servants and animals of the emperor would be slaughtered and buried with him. So there was a very big impact on a culture. I think what we know about lots of cultures of the world over time has to do with clay shards, what people drew on their pots, and how they carved into their pots, what the pieces were made for. I think when I was thinking about culture, it seemed so multi-layered to me that I thought about, you know, like Keith, Western culture, the U.S. culture today as we sit here. But also, I live in Huntington, it's the hill towns. I feel like I'm influenced by that culture. I think your family and your family traditions and your home environment and the traditions, the history of your personal family are all the cultural influences that impact all of us. And so I think when I thought about it, I think that both of personal and cultural have to be part of all of it, because how can you, like, what makes someone an individual is your responses to the cultural influences. So, but I think in play it's gone way more personal, I think art, from a play standpoint, used to be much more around the home or storage of food or storage of seeds. It impacted cultures in all kinds of ways. I think of divine spiritual vessels made, which are tied to the religions of many cultures. And I kind of think we're at this place where we are about the individual. And we're living in an era where the importance of the individual seems to be at the top. And so we need to sign our names, and our names need to be visible relative to the art that we're making. So I see my own work as more of a reaction to our culture, not an embracing of our culture. But I also think, if I were going to follow this thought through right to the end, that even if I, all right, because then I would also, can I keep going here? I would look at like who the dominant culture is, and if you're a representative of the dominant culture, then you might have choices available to you that not all people do. So if you're part of a group that maybe your voice isn't being heard, or you feel like you're somewhat disenfranchised, then I think there will be a more cultural movement around art so that the voice is a louder voice. And I think that the more polarized we are, which is where we are right now, the more each group seeks self-definition, and therefore art reflects your culture, and therefore I think cultural movements in art are going to prevail, or they'll be coming. I mean, even in response to what happened yesterday, I'm sure we'll be seeing much in the art world in reaction to it. But that's what I think. I think right now where I find myself, I react to my culture. I feel very out of sync with my culture. I feel like I take distance in many ways from my culture. And my art allows me to do that. So, and it feeds something in that way, so I'm grateful. So that's all my thinking.
Great. I love that you mentioned sort of the idea, because I've been thinking a lot about like the Black Lives Movement and how there's been a lot of art shows that have come up where it's one voice coming up to sort of say, hey, this is happening, so maybe this turmoil that's starting will sort of bring voices together to kind of come up out of this very individualistic, celebrity-driven culture that we are sort of involved in right now, and that's sort of, I am giving my opinion about where I think things are. So thank you for that.
Thank you.
Anybody like to
go next? I'll go next. So like Linda, I thought about this a lot in my daily musings and driving. I think a lot of the answers you're going to hear from the panel is that, you know, personal expression and culture, or cultural expression, merge. You know, they kind of live in the same plane. As a graphic designer, that's a perspective I think I'm most comfortable kind of sharing with you. As a graphic designer, I think we are hired to speak to culture. We're hired to advertise to culture. Everything that we do is, in essence, a cultural expression. Our personal aesthetic or our personal style is kind of shining through that advertising and through that work. But I do think about that there are designers out there who really do touch upon the cultural narrative. So I think about artists like Banksy. I think about artists like Shepard Fairey, who have a very personal style, but what they're doing is they're speaking to culture in the form of dissent. They're speaking to culture by challenging the narrative. And I think as a designer and as artists, that's the most interesting thing that we do, is that we can actually go counterculture. We can actually challenge the entire narrative that's set upon the nation. Like yesterday's events, you know, think about all the great artworks that's going to come out of this. I've thought about four pieces already. So I think that from my perspective, we do start with very personal expression, but ultimately for all of us in all disciplines, it has to be a cultural expression, because what we're doing is we're being the mirror to the actual world.
Right. You notice that you have a part of your teaching methodology. You do a project of Banksy,
yes.
Shepard Fairey.
Yes, street art.
Yeah, street art. Mm-hmm. So it's great that you talked about that here, taking that into what you're doing in the classroom too. So thank you.
I would say, George knows, culturally I'm kind of like the opposite. I actually have like, I don't even have an iPhone. I actually have, not a flip phone, but like one that kind of slides back and forth to text. So, like Linda, I'm kind of away from popular culture. I don't really care about it. I'm aware of it, but so I think often what I create in my work is kind of against that culture of this quick and easy, fast. You can't tell, your attention span's 2 seconds. You kind of, I want to gather something and move on. That stuff drives me nuts. It drives me crazy that people can't stop. I know in my class I show documentaries, and they're like documentaries from like the 80s, and they're too slow for you guys. You're just like falling asleep. You're like, it's not fast enough, you know. But sometimes that's slowing down, so I guess my, the anti-cultural thing is what I really want to do. I guess that, you know, my personal expression comes out of that, this cultural trend, I guess, with what's kind of happening there. So that's how I kind of deal with culture, you know, and that way there. You can see with many work in here, they're kind of stripping down stuff, simplifying things, making you ask why or what they're doing, trying to slow you down, to make you stay in front of it and kind of figure it out. It's not an easy read. And like yesterday, it's definitely not an easy read, but you know, it's kind of just kind of that way there. So I guess I'm kind of anti-culture. My personal expression is in that way there.
Sorry.
Okay. Well, my thinking, as well. As Angela mentioned, she touched on briefly earlier, at the turn of the 19th to the 20th century, there was this, the Industrial Revolution was taking place, and we were moving from an agricultural to industrial society, and two artists that developed were Vincent van Gogh and Paul Gauguin. And Vincent van Gogh is a totally self-expressive, gut-wrenching artist. I mean, you know, when you come upon him, one of his canvases, it's like he reaches out and punches you in the stomach. You know, it has that kind of totally expressive quality, okay? And not to say that Gauguin isn't expressive, okay, but he went off to Tahiti to get involved in another culture, okay? So then we have the beginning of the introduction of another culture into society at large, but in his painting in particular, okay? And that happened later with Picasso and Matisse when they began to react to African art, okay? So we begin to have this influx of other cultures, you know, into the art world, okay? Moving very rapidly ahead, okay. With the rise of the civil rights movement, okay, that notion of black power also gave rise to, oh, wait a minute, how about gay power? How about Latino power? How about women power? Okay. And what happens is that there begins to be this diversion in terms of we have all these different cultures, okay? You know, I mean, like driving up here today, and I was trying to get some fantastic thought in my head, you know, and I said, like, oh, well, wait a minute, you know, like, you know, my friend George here, who I love, his experience in the world is really very different from mine, okay? You know, as I like to joke with my students, I'm the old white guy. You know, and I am the old white guy. I had a privileged life. It's called white privilege, okay? I could go any place, I could do anything and whatnot. I know some of George's story because he's shared it with me, but his life is very different. It was very different, you know? He was a Latino growing up in New York, okay? So, you know, he has that. So my cultural background is different from his cultural background, okay? One of the things that, you know, I asked myself, it's like, one of the things that came out of that movie, for instance, one of the questions that was asked was like, what is black art, okay? So African-American artists, many of them were painting images which were, you know, related to their situation, okay? But interestingly enough, I don't think anybody asked, what is white art? What is white art? You know, what is that all about?
Okay.
There's a challenge, I think, okay? Probably for some PhD candidate, which I am not, okay? To give you sort of a roundabout different aspect of that, you know, I have a good friend named Charles Gaines who is African-American. He teaches at Caltech in Los Angeles, has for many years. Okay. 2 years ago, he had a retrospective at the Studio Museum in Harlem, and I was fortunate to get to New York to see the show. Spectacular, spectacular work, okay? Now, the thing is that Charles Gaines, African-American, is a conceptual artist. So when you walk in there and you see his work, you have no idea if he's black, white, purple, green, orange, or male or female, because the work is conceptual, okay? And he even got a little bit of grief because it wasn't quote unquote black art, okay? So all of that raises the question of, you know, I think one of the things that's happening is that we have become more pluralized, and there is a searching for, you know, this culture that we have, okay? You know, and that's one of the terrifying thoughts that's come out of the presidential election, okay? And part of that has turned to art, which has become more about idea than it is about expressing, gut-wrenching expression. It's expresses an idea, but not expresses like emotion and feeling and whatnot, so on, okay? I mean, like the recent edition of Art Forum, which I just got the other day, the cover of it is a silkscreen print, which you can't see the bottom part here, but it says, imagine a world without America. Sort of apropos, given the election, I know it wasn't timed that way, okay? But, you know, and this is a total scripting, America doesn't exist, okay? And so what this is really could be considered in some way a cultural expression as opposed to a personal expression, okay? I mean, of course, intellectually you can start to split hairs on it, but I'll leave it at that. But I think but one of the changes that is really taking place is that last night I was... my youngest son called, he's 28 years old, and he has one of these. And so we were talking, you know, catching up with him, blah, 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 blah. I won't tell your family stories. Maybe I will. But anyway, he asked, he knew that I just had this show, And he said, yeah, I saw some of the images on Facebook. And I said, oh, okay. And he said, well, I'd like to see all the work. And I said, well, I said, you know, a friend of mine took all the photographs of them, and I'll get them together on a CD, and I'll send it to you. And he said, a CD? A CD? Dad, I don't have any place to put a CD. He said, just put them on Instagram. I said, Instagram? I don't have Instagram. You know, I mean, I'm an old white guy, you know? But the point I want to make is, you see, this is going to change our culture. If it hasn't already, it is, okay? Now, I don't know what the ramifications of that are. Okay, I know the ramification is that, you know, students are sitting in class doing stuff on this when they shouldn't be. That I know. But I mean, this again is so the thing about culture is what it's evolving. It's not constant. It's not constant. Okay. So I'll leave it at that.
Yeah, Maggie. Yeah. Okay.
Great. What you guys said.
I think that these answers are great, and I'm having a lot of sort of dialogue with you guys as you're, you know, we're all talking about this. So I'm trying to think about what I don't want to really necessarily reiterate, but I really relate to a lot of what sort of all of you were talking about. I think that what first came to mind with this question was, I actually wondered if it was a relevant question, or if it was a question that was something maybe more of a question that would have come out of modernism, or a sort of kind of movement from modernist to postmodern, or that kind of question. And I sort of thought that it was. And the more that I kind of, you know, I think like George, you were saying, I gave this a lot of thought, and I've been so busy, and I've been feeling, I wish I could sit down and really think about it. I actually took this book out that I like to refer to a lot. I've been carrying it around and meaning to go back in and finding my little highlight moments and seeing, is there something I can find in here that addresses? And I haven't been able to, but it's right here, so by osmosis, yeah. But I have been sort of thinking about this as I drive, and in that kind of way, because it's been coming up. And I think that it's really always a relevant kind of question, but maybe not so much as, you know, personal or cultural, right? And I think we mentioned this too, but just there's a constant relationship there. And this notion that you sort of can't really separate the two, even if you're making work that is sort of like what you were saying and what David was saying was sort of like almost like a reaction maybe against a certain kind of cultural maybe pace or some
direction.
Because we don't, and it gets into that idea of, you know, I think sometimes this idea of personal expression goes along with that kind of mythology of a kind of, you know, authentic, pure expression that exists in a vacuum. And it's always, there's always some kind of part of a collective that we're in. And, you know, I think that what maybe, how I kind of relate to this is a kind of turmoil that I'm sort of oftentimes questioning what am I doing, what is the sort of value of what I'm doing as an artist, with each particular project I happen to be doing. So I'm doing a project right now that's ongoing that involves a very sort of laborious drawing practice that is very much based in line and slowness and repetition. And I'm finding that to be a kind of reaction to the anxiety-producing pace partially of the world that we live in, and that has to do with world events, kind of, you know, the micro and macro of that. And so I'm wondering if this sort of making of art in so many different ways, and there's also social practice, which is something that I think is really relevant to this question. Is it inherently somewhat of, you know, a political act to be a maker? Is there something that in that way, I think, sort of combining the political with cultural and social as a kind of broader definition. Is there something in my kind of returning to line that is some kind of a political act? And I don't know, and I hope that it is. I do know that lately I've been thinking about kind of going back to this, like, you know, as soon as we sort of recognize this, the culture emerges, right? We start to see visual representation, right? And that is in the form of, we can say line, even if it's shape, right? And then I'm thinking about that moment as being a connecting one. And that connects not only just to sort of the students, right? Students that are like, you know, we're practicing line. Like, what is that? That becomes something much more about a larger kind of humanity. And I don't know that that's cultural, but it feels like something that's kind of universal, actually. I don't usually use that word.
The word.
I like sort of cringe usually with that word, but that's something that I think I've just really been thinking about that lately, about that kind of connecting moment of making a line.
I guess like going back to clay.
That's a personal answer, yeah.
Like that.
Yeah.
Like connect that, the line, the mark making within culture, the using pottery as a way of creating culture. So sort of that, those things
yes.
are really basic and really simple, but that clay is basic and simple, but there is an element of it that it is sort of like, there it is.
And there's an immediacy maybe
yeah.
to that.
And people can relate to it, because even if you're not drawing
yes.
it, but you are writing, although now that we do have our
That's
tablets
true.
And phones, we are moving away from actually writing where cursive isn't being taught in schools anymore, things like that. I mean, this is getting on a thing, but
yeah.
It sort of brings it together.
Yes.
Anyway, so.
Yes, and it's fascinating.
Going back to, we were talking about culture and both teaching, you were asking earlier about
yeah.
teaching and all that stuff. I think, in language about where we come from, our family, you know. And I think one thing in teaching that my experience of school and my experience of becoming from a, which I think a lot of us are, which I don't think many people think, maybe some people think artists are that are this kind of this, come from this wealthy family or this kind of status thing, but I mean, most of us had parents who probably didn't graduate from high school. Neither of my parents graduated from high school. My dad got his GRE in the military. You know, my mom got it eventually. And you know, I always could draw. And my parents always encouraged me. I was very, very fortunate, you know, and then I could do it. It was like, people always ask me sometimes, well, why did you become an artist? I'm like, well, that's all I can do. Like, that's what I do. You know, I don't play baseball, I don't write, I don't send emails well, you know, I just draw. And so I've been fortunate. And so I kind of got through undergraduate school and I got into grad school. I'm like, this is kind of cool. And this is a cultural thing. And so that was a different level. I went to Boston University and that was a different level. It wasn't a state school. You know, and people came from all over the country to BU. And I went to UMass Dartmouth, not UMass Amherst. And people would say to me, oh, you went to Dartmouth College. And I would say, no. I would say, UMass Dartmouth. And like, yeah, Dartmouth. And they're thinking with the Dartmouth, the Ivy League school. And because their cultural lives were, they had more opportunities for good or for bad, than me. Not saying my parents didn't provide that, but my parents didn't know about this class you can take over the summer, this whatever. And I think that's why I push a lot of you guys, is that you don't know. I mean, there's, you know, you may be your best in your high school, and you get to here, shaking his head, and then you're like, well, I got this other guy who's good as I am now, here, and you know, and what's gonna be next? You know, and who else is going to be there? And, you know, most of you probably do not come from a wealthy family or people who have an art or whatever. Many of you may have come from families with no, parents have no college degree, you know, similar to what I did, you know. And it's a lot of work, you know, but that culture, I mean, I kind of think that's good sometimes that I didn't have that because I have way more work ethic than other people. Because I'm like, you know, I got to do this, you know, and you know, a lot of what if I did is because I have done it, not because of people have given it to me or people
right.
or I knew someone, you know, there's that cultural thing too of kind of providing things and you know that way there. But I'm kind of like the black sheep of my family, like the flip side. You like, you know, I'm the one who did all this stuff. You know, all my uncles were in jail or drug addicts or. You know, and somehow my dad and my mom got me away from that, you know. And a lot of good artists, Keith brings up all these names. I mean, Van Gogh would be someone who came from nothing. Gauguin would be not. But Picasso, I mean, these people just came from, you know, they just were just normal families. They, you know, they just had talent there. That's why I push you guys a lot, because it's, as George knows, everyone knows, it's not easy out there.
So I would Do we have time to open up?
Yeah.
Okay, great. Would anybody like to ask him questions about anything?
Talk, yeah.
Thanks. What are your guys' thoughts on plagiarism as artists?
I have to say that for the first time ever in my pottery class, I had to announce that you can't go to Pinterest and have your phone open on a table and be using the picture that you see on the screen to copy in the classroom. And that happened because this summer I had a student who was making really beautiful work, which I showed to the rest of my class, and I don't go online either. I mean, I do when I have to, but not very much. And my other students were saying, oh, I saw that on Pinterest, and I saw that. Oh, she made that. That was on Pinterest. And so all of a sudden, I became aware of how easy it is to lift a design. And so this is the first semester I've vocalized that to my students. And so if you see it, so that is plagiarism, and that could fail you in your class, or in some schools get you kicked out of school. If there is no, I mean, we are all borrowing ideas, and like Keith said, stealing. I see my students the same thing, try things that I think, well, I'm gonna try that too. And all of that is an exchange of ideas which moves us all upward and forward. But I do think it's so easy now to use these images and recreate the images, and I would hope that that isn't going, that that's not a trend. And that's my classroom experience with it.
You know, I think for graphic design, you know, there was a time through modernism where you were kind of copying each other and people were kind of doing the same thing. Then, you know, postmodernism kind of sprung up. And the postmodernism graphic design were very clear about the idea of plagiarizing. In fact, when they looked at any design that looked like someone else's, they called it out. So the idea has transformed to being inspired by it. So I think in my classes, when I see work that has a similar taste, feel, look to another work, I look at, all right, you were obviously inspired by, but let's just make sure you add elements that speak to your aesthetic. You know, like Linda said, people can try to get away with pure 100%, make it look like the other designer. Does that mean it's not legitimate? I still kind of, you know, on the fence on that one. Because it's different for graphic design. We just look at the past and we take from it.
But not really. I mean, we all kind of, because Keith was saying, and we all are always recycling. Like, we're always recycling, you know, images, you know.
Graphic design has such a short history relative to many of, you know, the history of some of these other people. So maybe that's part of it.
Hopefully, this means sort of we were talking about how you do the street art class, which is, that's a very specific style those artists have.
Mm-hmm.
But sort of at a foundational level, there's a long history of like you paint like somebody until you can find your voice too.
Exactly.
So it's like
right.
A very interesting, right. Tricky time too at this point in your conversation. I mean, going straight up and going to someone's thing and like building it exactly, that's not, you're not learning anything from that, but it is important, like studying.
You're learning from that. Yeah.
Yeah, but you're not going to go out and be like, this is my portfolio. I just did these wonderful paintings that look like Alice Neal or something. But,
because you're called out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But there's also an amazing, does anybody know the artist Richard Price? There was
yeah.
a big thing that happened a couple of years ago where he basically printed all these photos that this other photographer had taken. What country was it in? That part doesn't matter, but this book of photos this artist Richard Prince had done, and I think he's a really interesting figure, and I kind of go back and forth because I understand like culturally what he's trying to say with this practice, but also it's like he just really bit this person's complete body of work, so it gets dicey, and I would be curious about people's opinions on that if you know. I can't remember
if it's specifically about that though.
Yeah, and then it's, so he's an artist that's dealing with that
mm-hmm.
stuff, and so does that conversation need to happen, or doesn't it, and sort of like moving culturally forward in this time that we're in. Like, I kind of feel like it's an important body of work, but
right.
It does feel yucky, too.
Right. And is it plagiarism if it's in that case?
In that case.
Does anyone remember the name of the artist who is a woman photographer?
I don't remember.
Okay,
so this is also like...
Okay, anyway.
Oh, Sherry Levine. Those photos too, where she reproduced all these photos. Were they from the Depression era? Were they from the Dust Bowl and stuff?
Right?
So she reproduced all these famous photographers that were not considered artists. They were. It was like Department of Public Works, WPA projects.
So.
Well,
and you just sort of mentioned that too. That you're saying like there was that sort of shift from like modernism to postmodernism,
mm-hmm.
and in that moment of like appropriation
yeah.
art, and that's a different conversation, I think, than what plagiarism is.
Yeah.
Right? So
yeah.
appropriation art meaning like taking actual images from someone else's artwork and then recontextualizing them into something else, and not right, not
yeah.
kind of like. Pretending you're not doing that, like doing that on purpose, that's part of it, kind of like, I feel like it sounds like sampling or something, but maybe not. But, you know, it's interesting because I'm like,
I don't know what I know about plagiarism.
Like when you say like, what's our, what's our policy or what's your thoughts on plagiarism? I have one for written assignments. If I have students doing a response to an artist, they have to cite their work. I'm fairly loose personally on citations, but I do have people kind of, you know, try to go to library sources and understand how to properly cite things, right? I encourage people to go to artists' websites and kind of read what the artist's voice is and then sort of try to separate their own interpretation. And I find that students plagiarize a lot in written form. In design class, I am finding people, you know, it's interesting this like Zentangle situation that's happening. Because a lot of design projects, you know, suddenly these Zentangle kind of approaches. Have you seen this Zentangle? It's a Zentangle. It's like this sort of way of drawing that shows you different patterns and you can kind of plug them in. And it's very much a lot like a lot of the design projects we do. Do you guys know what I'm talking about? Okay, a little bit. So I'm finding that I don't mind certain looking a little bit for certain patterns, and then they can't use it exactly. Changes have to be made and reconfigured.
Right.
So, but it's a good question, for sure.
What do you think about it?
Well, I think I relate to him most because my problem, like, I know, like, I'm talented, I know I can draw, but I relate back a lot to the internet. I think to gain ideas and, like, that creative, like, process in my head, like, isn't there, like, I don't know my style, and I get frustrated. And all that kind of stuff, so I was curious.
Mm. I think about one designer in particular, Paula Shear, who did a swatch poll. She made her poster look exactly like a poster from the Bauhaus, and she won an award for it. You know, and what I found so hard was that when it came to talking about Paula Shear's work in public, a lot of designers just burned her in front of her contemporaries. To the point where at conferences she would present it and it would burn her, and then she'd be up right after showing her great poster. You know, it becomes this thing of, can we not borrow from each other? Can we not look at each other's style? Because, you know, like you said, we do have the talent, but it's almost like an appreciation program.
Yeah,
and you can't help but do it. I mean, and we're bombarded with imagery, you guys in particular. All day, every day. So.
And of course, everyone thinks differently, so it's really important to.
That's right.
Look upon that too, so.
But you guys don't. I don't think you guys want to plagiarize. No. So visually, I don't think it's ever a problem. Like pushing you guys to do something that's looking at an idea, but you guys don't. It's interesting that you bring that up because, you know, you bring up this question of style. I mean. It'll come.
I know, yeah.
Right,
it's
you know.
It's just obviously, I feel like I'm just...
Right, but you know, but that's what you're doing, you know. Your drawing today was different than, you know, the person besides you drawing.
Yeah.
You're drawing the same person. And just, you know, just who you are is going to be different than Jake. And going to be different than Anthony, no matter how much you kind of... And what Keith's saying lately, you know, that you get these projects year and year and year again, and you're amazed how different everybody approaches it, you know. You give them three or four guidelines of four or five things.
Mm-hmm.
You guys always go with different, it always blows my mind.
Mm-hmm.
So, but his question way back then.
No, I was gonna say, like, I'm
only taking like art history classes. I'm a poli-sci major, but isn't like imitation in a way like the greatest form of flattery, especially in art? And in a sense, like as long as it's not in vain, right? As long as you're not doing it to like take notoriety for that person's style, like in the Renaissance, they were doing that. Like they were in the Sienese school, is what I'm learning. And they're like one artist would copy, or not copy, but learn that style, then develop his own out of that. So I think, as long as you're not doing it in vain, am I right or am I wrong? I don't know.
Yeah. So I would say, let's say if I'm doing it, right? I would say my piece inspired by. I think that's a better way of kind of pulling it all together. So
yeah.
Instead of saying,
and you should be able to see George's piece and look at the piece that inspired it, and they not be duplicates of each other.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But that sort of system was a very different system back then,
right.
Yeah.
Of what that was, because it was sort of a guild system, and that was the intention, because you were supposed, there's this one person who is the master, and you are working under them to create these paintings, so it was like 20 people would work on a painting to get it done, and so it all had to look the same, so that's sort of a different, we live in a different time, yeah. But...
It's a good point, I mean,
yeah.
She brings up a good point, a lot of those paintings are, you know, that person who signed that painting did like, you know, like this much of the painting of it. And everything else was done by people in the studio.
Which something like Dolly was like that near the end of his life.
Right.
He did sort of an apprentice, it's like an apprentice guild, apprenticeship would be sort of the blah, blah, blah.
What about like including places that are like, I'd almost say like animation studios and like the art factories. But the entire idea is that they all look the exact same, so that it keeps like almost to a brand, or they're different artists and like loads of different artists, but they're, your job is to look the exact same as previous artists, so that there's, as I think someone put it, Disney quotes it as, the reason why everything looks the exact same is to keep a like sense of wonder to you looking at it every time. I say plagiarism isn't in like a large sort of like graphic design is like almost a necessary part, or like being inspired by it is a part of what you're being paid to do.
Mm-hmm. Part of that language too is the consistency of her speaking within that context of that language. Like in that case, it's about the homogeny, so it's almost like. Required.
You know, it comes down to a tattoo artist. You're almost kind of the same thing too. When you go to when you want to get a tattoo, sometimes it's maybe you like that guy's. You want that tattoo, you know, and that guy's doing a tattoo like 20 times, like, you know. Or else sometimes you may go to like their style of, you know, you kind of have your own idea of it that way. They're not even plagiarizing, but you have this homogeny where you're talking about that. It doesn't matter who did it, it's the look that you want, not the person.
Well, there's also, maybe this is jumping into something else, but things end up going back into the public realm after a certain amount of time. I don't know with visual art, maybe fine arts, it doesn't ever, but things like with graphic design, does that end up happening? Mm-hmm. So was that the sort of thing that happened with that poster? Was that sort of, it was
right.
Bauhaus was back in the public domain.
And she did it
so
on purpose.
She did it all
she did it on purpose. Yeah.
Okay.
That was the horrible thing about it.
Yeah.
She did it on purpose as an homage.
Mm-hmm.
And they still tore up.
Wow. So it's interesting because she was being aware.
She was fully aware of what she did.
Of that.
To the same scarf, to the same lettering, to the same everything, even the mountains in the background.
Was she, and in this particular situation, was she, this is like a design kind of world?
Yeah.
Swatch.
So
Swatch.
She took an old campaign.
Like, who is it that's taking her part? Like art critics.
Other designers
it's
and
design,
critics.
Designer.
Yeah, design critics, yeah.
You know what I'm getting at, though? Like, it's almost a different conversation if she's sort of, I don't know, maybe within a contemporary art context versus design world question.
So it's interesting because maybe in like a gallery system or like a museum setting, they would really like, although a design museum, they must be still ripping her apart. It just sort of seems like where the like shift, like that, like the words between design and fine art, like where that shift happens,
I've been
like what happens.
That this whole time everyone's talking about these,
yeah.
Like, there are two different worlds we're talking.
No,
but
totally.
Not really. I don't think so. I don't think so. No, I mean, contemporary artists, you know, do whatever they want to do.
Together.
Exactly. Whatever the tool is, whatever the medium, whatever they want to say, yeah. How can I say that?
But I do think, like, within the design world, there is still, like, a criteria and different functions.
It's engineering. It's engineering.
Sure.
Yeah. It is. There's science and engineering to it, and that has to be duplicated.
Yeah. But maybe the medium is crossing borders, or the theory's crossing borders.
Where, like, to have the conversation in a fine art setting, I guess I'm going to do that. Like, that poster would be like because there's the artists like Sherry Living in Rich Prince we talked about, like that is sort of in the same vein as that campaign, but within this other world that is, it's your artists, but also you have these criteria to hold to that you've agreed upon as a group making these things, that conversation
which would apply to. I think to so many things.
Yeah,
like if you technically make a poor pot, it will blow up in the town.
Yep.
So there are techniques that everyone needs to follow in order to survive through to the end of the process, mm-hmm. hoping that you mm-hmm. apply some individuality to the work that you're doing. Mm-hmm. But, so
another wonderful conversation I think is too big for today, but
I'd like to draw attention back to what you said when you said that this day in culture that particularly our age, we just like things fast-paced, and most people don't take time to look at art. They just like, oh, that's cool, and pass by it. Or like even like things on social media, they'll look at it and be like, oh, but they don't appreciate the background that comes in. And do you instill that in your students, or do you think it'll get worse as time progresses? I just wonder your views on it.
I think there'll be a reaction and opposition. That's what I'm hoping for. Because in the world of clay, you have to go really slow. It makes you stop, that you can't make a pot fast. They won't survive if you do. I mean, you could under certain circumstances, but generally no. So my hope is that, and I hear students, like I have a student whose cell phone broke one night and she told me that she worked on a painting all night and finished it and would never have done that if people were texting or phoning her. So I think there are people who are taking breaks from it, and but when you think about the imagery on Facebook, I'm not on Facebook, but you're getting image after image all day, every day. I read that people check their phones 46 times a day, and when I run that by my students, they'll go, yep, or more than 46 times a day. So, there's input from something from another place than there has ever been before, and that social media has a huge impact, I think.
And does that concern you?
Yes. Yes is my short answer to it. Yes, it does, because I think it eclipses so much else, and I think it makes us be, we are connected in a, I feel like privacy and autonomy get lost, like you guys don't have it anymore. And I think that the highest points of development and creative activity happen when people are alone. So that when you're in your space with a block of time and you're not subject to all of the distractions that daily life hit you with. And so it is worrisome to me. Although at the same time I see students make beautiful clay pieces and the pottery room becomes a little bit of a therapy area away from all of the hecticness of life, so it feels like that will continue. It's, you know, it's all the elements of design, right? Balance, contrast. Balance and contrast. Movement, it's what we're all looking for in our lives. We apply it to our art, you can apply it to your life.
You brought up a good point, the history. That's another thing. A lot of you guys don't care about history. Like, what, you know, why are you showing me this thing? This happened, you know, 200 years ago, blah, 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 blah. But it's interesting that you brought up, because obviously you are aware of that, you know, the importance of the content of it, or the context of it. So good job being aware of that.
And, you know, truthfully, even though we might be concerned about it, or I might be, it's here is where we are, and it's
right.
The reality of our time. And so adaptability is a really big survival skill, and so we all adapt to ways of surviving around all of it. And my way of adapting is to not participate in it, which has worked pretty good so far.
It's great that we are on this panel. We're talking about culture and expressionism, how our own ideas are affected by a certain movement or by a certain inspiration. My question for you is, if we get too focused on specific culture, on specific style, or specific idea, or just culture in general, that kind of takes away from the substance of what art is supposed to mean in different mediums, different ways of teaching, and different kinds of art. If we just limit ourselves, does that kind of wash over the real substance, say in pottery, drawing, graphic design, sculpture, painting, so on and so forth?
I would say it doesn't feel like if you have no choice but to be influenced by your culture unless you live in a vacuum. So I don't see that as limiting. I see it as really enriching, you know, to look beyond yourself and to respond to what's happening in the world beyond who you are, and to be able to have an avenue of expression so that you can get that out of you and wherever it goes to. I think we are all incredibly lucky that these are the choices we've made in our lives and that we get to live this way every day. So good luck to all of you.
Yeah.
Could I say one more thing?
Of course.
This feels like a very nice cultural activity. You know, here we are, a group of people who all share some common values, and so what we're doing is we're participating in something, again, larger. I, on a rainy day like this, would have loved to be in my studio working on this dinnerware set I owe some people. And it was so great to pull out of that, to be here to experience you all as a group, and you all as a group, and thank you very much, Andrew.
Yeah, thank you, Andrew.
Thank you. Thanks, my pleasure.
Thank you guys for coming.